Well, good morning, San Francisco. I've always wanted to say that. My name is Kristen Spaeth.
I'm Kelsey Dean, and we are on Coinbase's global intelligence team. I managed to not spill coffee on myself this morning, so got that going for me so far.
Thank you, everyone, for attending today's session. One of my guiding principles in life is to never assume anything. So for those who are unaware, Coinbase is a cryptocurrency exchange wherein a user is able to buy, sell, store, and transfer digital currency. Kelsey and I are on the global intelligence team, and we act as the liaisons between Coinbase and law enforcement. So we investigate a myriad of suspicious activity on the platform, including but not limited to terrorist financing, child exploitation, account takeovers, to really any sort of financial fraud-related crime. And we really particularly leverage blockchain analysis in order to get to the pinpoint of our investigations. Now today, we are going to be talking to you about one-time password stealing bots, otherwise referred to as OTP bots. We're going to be talking about the general framework and architecture of it all, as well as how it's a really serious emerging threat to victims, to people in pretty much any sort of financial institution. So let's get started. Disclaimer. All right, so what is an OTP bot and when did this kind of all begin? So OTP bots have been around for a little while now, but they really started gaining popularity in 2021. Specifically in July, there was a surge. An OTP bot automates the theft of someone's one-time password. They usually are sold on Telegram for about like $500 to $700 in cryptocurrency, which is where we come in. These OTP bots target financial services looking to take over accounts of victims. The way that it works is that the bot is a robocall, calls up the victim, impersonates the financial institution where they have the account, and they trick the victim into providing their one-time password. From there, the attacker then can then go into the victim's account, take it over, pretty much drain them financially. So how does an OTP bot essentially work? First, the attacker. The attacker needs to obtain the victim credentials of the account that they want to take over. And typically that is purchased off of a darknet forum. It could be through a WhatsApp or a Telegram scam forum where they can buy a dump, or sometimes called fulls, where it's victim information. So it provides date of birth, email address, username, login, password, pretty much anything and everything that is personal to you. The attacker then goes on these various Telegram channels. There are dedicated channels for these bots per bot. So the attacker is able to pick a bot of their choice. And then from there, they provide that victim information to the bot, who then calls the victim, impersonating, usually providing some sort of ruse that their account has had some sort of unauthorized activity on it. Pretty much scaring the victim into thinking like, okay, I didn't make that $58 transaction, but this, you know, I'm getting a call from my bank, so it has to be real. So throughout that, towards the end of the call or in the middle of it, the bot will ask for the user to type in their one-time password that was just provided as authentication that they did not commit the purchase that they are calling about to say that was unauthorized. Once that OTP is provided, there's usually a communication between the purchaser of the bot and the bot itself. So you're able to see that the call is in progress, and then you know the victim provided the password, and then the password is provided in plain text, and then the account takeover commences. And then in the next slide, Kelsey's going to go into a little bit of a deeper dive on the architecture.
So to get into a little bit more of the specific mechanics of how the bot is used in an account compromise, keep in mind that at this point, the attacker already has the login credentials of the victim for the financial institution. So from there, they're going to purchase the bot from the Telegram operator, and provide the identifying information of the victim. So the phone number and any PII that's going to help convince the victim that it is actually their financial institution calling. And then, of course, select the specific bank that the bot is going to try to spoof and the language. So this means that the attacker doesn't even necessarily have to speak the same language as the victim. The criminal server is then going to place a spoofed phone call to the victim, and the victim is going to enter their one-time password, which is then passed back to the OTP bot and then either shared with the attacker who enters that one-time password along with the login credentials to get access to the financial institution and then send funds off-site or conduct some sort of change to the account like a password reset. But there are some more sophisticated bots that even automate the full login, meaning that the login credentials are included in the automated takeover of the account. So what do some of these bots look like in practice? Why don't we listen to one and hear what that's like?
Registration attempt. If this was not you, please press 1. For security, and so we can block this request, we'll need to confirm your identity. Please key the 6-digit code we've sent you. When you're finished, please press pound.
All right, so let's talk about some OTP bots that are out in practice. Probably the most notable one on the market right now is SMS Ranger, and they actually advertise themselves as the most advanced SMS capture bot on the market. Their platform is easily accessible just from a basic Google search. So if you type in SMS Ranger on Google, it will bring you to their webpage. This is a screenshot of just their logo. That's the wrong button right there. Up here, their logo is a little cowboy. It says capturing SMS since 2021. And here, let's look at this a little bit further. So these are all captured just from the internet. I did not log into any sort of undercover credentials through Telegram. Nothing. This is just from accessing on the web. This is a screenshot of the SMS Ranger Telegram community. Community. There are thousands of people who are either involved, buyers, also interested in SMS Ranger. So up here, I keep doing the wrong button here. Sorry, guys. Up here at the top, they give updates on service. So say that it's very similar to your at-home service provider. So if you have Verizon and you don't have power, you're not getting internet that day, same thing with SMS Ranger. They will be posting updates on if it's working in the jurisdiction that you are looking to take over. Additionally, towards the bottom, it shows the languages as well as the different countries it operates in. Towards the bottom also, it says price per month and price for lifetime. So the price of a subscription, let's take it back a little bit. You can purchase these, the use of OTP bots in different forms. So you could have a 1-month subscription, you could have a lifetime subscription. They sometimes offer different packages, but here in this particular screenshot, the price per month is $1,500 and the lifetime subscription of use of the bot is $7,500. Now you might say that's a lot of money, but when you think of account takeovers, usually the attackers are not just taking $100 or so, they're targeting very high value accounts. So in just one successful account takeover, they can make all their money back and more. So this makes it very worthwhile. Additionally, at the top, it gives you some sort of statistics of how many people are in this channel. So here, there's 6,000 users in this channel, and there have been about 300 photos that are posted and like 54 videos. And you might think, like, what are those photos and videos? Well, in these channels, which I don't have screenshots of, they like to post promotions of this service. So what do those promotions look like? It's usually the purchaser of a bot sending a screenshot of a successful entry into a victim account. So that would be me taking a screenshot of me getting into Kelsey's Coinbase account, showing that she has a balance of $100 million, and because of SMS Ranger, I was able to get into her account and gain access to that. So that's what a lot of those photos and videos are in there. Additionally, they do also post frequent updates and whatnot. This one in particular is because SMS Ranger has a lot of competition and they have a lot of impersonators on the market as well. So what I find kind of ironic in this post is that they are telling the users in their community that SMS Ranger will never reach out to you. Don't fall for a dupe. So to me, that sounds very familiar to any financial institution. I actually got one this morning where they say, never give out your one-time password. We will never call you. We will never ask for it. So essentially, they're doing the same thing with their customers here. So this is a screenshot of SMS Ranger's basic website, just based off of Google. Here you can, there are two options to buy OTP Bot, the auto and the admin. If you wanted to purchase the admin role, you have to contact SMS Ranger directly through Telegram, and that is that's a little bit of a bigger subscription package for them. Additionally, towards the bottom, they have the updates and reviews, which are literally what I just said before, people posting up images that it worked and like putting great reviews online, say, like it's almost like a Yelp. It's just a Yelp for SMS Ranger. And then below is the community, the Telegram community. But let's go actually back to buying OTP Bot Auto. This is what most people are doing, or at least what we've been seeing. So if you click that on their web page, it brings you to a website, a payment processing page hosted by Celex. And here you can see that they have three packages up here that you could buy. Depending on what time of year you're buying, whatnot, they might have different things that are for sale, that they run different promotions. They also show how many of these packages are in stock. So there's seven trials in stock at the time that this was taken. But the funny thing is that before this presentation, I just wanted to make sure that I was giving the most up-to-date information for everybody here. So I looked at the channel last week, and they actually ran a Memorial Day special. So I'm going to read you word for word what they posted, and I'm not going to change any of the language. This is exactly how it was written. 30 days subscriptions. We'll be offering 4 weeks subscriptions at discount, but only for the next 2 days, in order to let people get the feel of the bot and gain some cash flow to eventually purchase the month. You guys asked and we listened. This 4 week subscription will only be sold once to each user. If you wanted to get the bot and try it out, here's your chance, don't miss out. Now, they were selling this subscription for about $399. Additionally, when you're on this site and you are going through the payment processing page on this, so say that I wanted to purchase the lifetime subscription. I click this, it brings you to a payment processing page wherein a user has to put in their email address, and then they are provided a cryptocurrency address to send funds. So as of last week, SMS Ranger was only accepting Bitcoin and Nano. However, in the past, Ethereum and Litecoin were accepted as well. So these addresses are very important for law enforcement, for us at Coinbase, because these addresses are not always one-time use addresses. And these addresses essentially can lead to the identification of the OTP bot operator. So why is this important? And how is this affecting us on a day-to-day basis? OTP bots are really easy to use, and they're a great tool for people who are awful at social engineering, because they don't have to do any of the work. I can't tell you how many times myself I've received a phone call from Coinbase customer support saying that my account has been taken over, and I'm literally talking to somebody else on the phone, and they're telling me that, you know, I have IP hits over in Indonesia, whatnot. And, you know, in my mind as an investigator, I'm thinking, okay, let me just like make sure that this actually isn't real. So I'm looking at my account in real time. They're telling me that it's being taken over, but OTP bots completely eliminate that use of a third person to help enhance this account takeover. Like, they're very easy to use. Those who pay for access, they can command things such as one would use on like a popular workforce tool, such as Slack. So I know at Coinbase, we have different channels where we do have bots automating things, just to make sure that the conversations there are on track and they stay on track. So if somebody posts something that would be more applicable to another channel, that bot would populate a response being like, hey, you should really go to this other channel to find an answer to your question. The same thing kind of works with OTP bots. Once the phone number is pretty much input, the bot does the rest of the work. And according to Intel 471, in a post that they made back in the fall of 2021, OTP bots have an 80% efficacy rating if the victim answers the phone call and the victim information that was provided was correct. So that means that they're successful about 80% of the time. Now, let's bring it to Coinbase. How are we able to identify these attacks, or at least detect them? It's really difficult to proactively prevent these attacks, and it's also really difficult to retroactively identify these attacks. Because there are so many different OTP bot operators on the market, it's hard to attribute any particular takeover to a bot without corroboration from, usually it's the victim saying that they were asked to provide their password. The bot is sold as a service to threat actors by threat actors. So each bot could be sold to 200 different people. That makes it so that way there could potentially be another 200 individual identity theft and fraud rings. So say that Kelsey is the operator of SMS Ranger. I'm one of 200 people that purchased that from her because I want to get into my group of victim accounts. Then it's like a trickle-down theory. So it's something that you can't necessarily prevent because you're not really sure when it's going to happen. You don't know what their attack patterns are. It's something that we're still trying to figure out. And additionally, not every attempt that they try to get into is successful. A lot of the advertisements in these channels are not true. So they could potentially have all the information to get into an account, but there is less than $1,000 in an account. And to me, if $1,000 were stolen from me, oh, I would be livid. I would not be happy at all. And I'm sure that most, if not all of you in here would be too. But in the scheme of an OTP bot and somebody taking over an account, $1,000 is not worth it for them. Through detection on our end, I know that I've scraped a lot of different channels and whatnot looking for things that mention Coinbase. And I've gone one by one to some of these images that they post stating that, look, it's a successful account takeover into a Coinbase account. And I'm looking at it, and the account only had $4.71 in it. Nothing was ever taken. It was a user that barely even used it. But they still got in, so that's what they wanted to promote, that the OTP bot was able to gain access, but the actual takeover of the account and the financial success wasn't really there. So also, as you could probably imagine, Coinbase has been the center of many attacks. But from our end, which is probably unique to most financial institutions and whatnot, we have been seeing the purchasers of the bot rather than the victims. And that's because this is bots are paid for in cryptocurrency. So that gives us the unique ability to go through blockchain analytics and try to go back and try to see where these funds are going. As I mentioned before, identified bot attacks on Coinbase accounts have not been successful. And typically, the purchaser of the bot uses their Coinbase account just to buy the bot and then trickle down to different financial institutions. Now, I'm going to speak about two investigations that Coinbase was successful in taking down two OTP bot operators. These two investigations are still ongoing, so I can't say everything, but I can share as much as I'm allowed to. So our first investigation that we began in October of 2021, through collaboration with our financial partners, we were alerted that Coinbase was being the target of an OTP bot attack, and we were provided a screenshot of a purchasing transaction of the bot and victim account information. So from there, what do we do? For me, I throw the address into our systems, the address that was used to purchase the bot, to see how many Coinbase users have interacted with the bot. Either best case scenario or worse, however you look at it, if I plug that address in and it went directly to a Coinbase user, that's great, because then I am able to attribute that the operator of that bot is that user. However, that's not how this particular investigation went. I threw the address into our systems and was able to identify 103 unique users that purchased the bot. Some of these users, they were repeat users, repeat purchasers, and some of their transaction notes indicated that it was for OTP bot. It was for that particular user. So it was pretty easy to say, okay, they were not sending their grandma funds. So through there, through some collaborative efforts as well, and extensive blockchain analysis, we were able to identify a particular person that all the funds were going back to. And through law enforcement, we were actually able to find out that that particular person gained access to the program from another darknet forum, and it was actually created in Russia. So earlier this year, that person, they were arrested, charged, they pleaded guilty. Sentencing is sometime this year, I think it's in the summer, and $500,000 worth of cryptocurrency was recovered, and efforts are being made to bring that back to the victims. Now, the second investigation that we had, that began in November of 21. Again, we were alerted from some intel that we had another bot that was targeting Coinbase. So off to the races again. This particular investigation was a little bit different because we interacted with the bot and completed two undercover purchases with them, which that gave us some great insight because that was able to allow us to see their attack patterns in real time. How are they accessing the account? Because when somebody accesses the account or an account, they have a particular or a specific methodology and whatnot. So sometimes you're able to group attack patterns because maybe it took them 0.2 seconds to crack the password or that password reset button. Or you see that the user agent string is all in, I don't know, say Portuguese. That would be something unique, and you could be like, okay, there are other accounts that were kind of grouped together with that same sort of methodology. But going back to those undercover purchases, we were able to see that, but then we were also provided an address by the OTP bot, because this one worked a little bit differently. This one was able to obtain access into the account. They were the ones who did the total takeover. So we provided a dummy account information for Coinbase. We had some funds in there, and the OTP bot took a 50-50 split of the money. But through there, in order to receive the funds as the purchaser of the bot, they had to give us an address. So again, through extensive blockchain analysis, I was able to find an address that led to three Coinbase users sending funds to it. And at that point in the investigation, I was able to determine that those three users weren't purchasers of the bot. They were the operators of the bot. and through other collaboration with other institutions, we were able to corroborate identity. And those three users, one was in Bangladesh, one was in the UK, and one was in Pakistan. And all three of them were apprehended earlier this year, and that's as much as I can say about that.
So as those two investigation successes highlighted, the fact that these bots are being purchased with cryptocurrency creates a huge intelligence gathering opportunity for fighting financial crime, because the payment infrastructure is transparent. Any of these purchases of the bot and then where that address transfers their money to what we refer to as cash out, you know, convert the crypto to a local fiat like USD or euros, is going to be publicly accessible by any of us by going to a blockchain explorer. And once we've engaged with the bot and know the address that is receiving payment, you can plug that address into the explorer and see every transaction it's ever conducted. What we have noticed is that most of these bots are receiving payment in Bitcoin, Ethereum, or Litecoin. And we haven't really seen privacy coins being used. So they're not using particularly sophisticated methodologies for laundering the funds either. But we're really hoping to impress upon you is that this creates a huge opportunity. And this was really the value that we were able to add to this investigation is tracing those funds of the buyers and the sellers. So a tool that we use for this analysis very frequently, this is a graph created using TRM Labs, which is a blockchain analysis software that allows us to visualize the payment flows and then also helps provide attribution. So it does open source research and analysis of kind of patterns of activity of lots of large services in crypto and is able to attribute who might operate certain addresses. So the center circle here is an Ethereum address that we received from one of these controlled buys that is receiving payment for OTP bots. And the larger circles on the outer ring are actually other exchanges that are paying into this OTP bot. So you can see Coinbase actually has a payment into the bot, and all the payment amounts are roughly for 0.2 ETH, so roughly around the same amount. So that indicates that all of these circles sending funds into the bot are purchasing the OTP bot. So this creates one avenue of investigation into the purchasers. So looking into the Coinbase account activity of that purchaser, we can see, are they also receiving funds from other exchanges? Do they have kind of an anomalously large amount of crypto coming in, which might suggest that those funds are also illicitly obtained from successful account takeovers on other platforms using the OTP bot. But the other prong of the investigation is where is this architect of the OTP bot then cashing their funds out? So you can see that the funds are actually accumulated and sent to, it's not called other exchange, FYI, sent to another exchange in kind of like accumulated larger transactions. And by sharing these transaction hashes with law enforcement, they're able to subpoena the other exchange for the subscriber information that is receiving those funds and essentially de-anonymize who is operating this bot. So very quickly, we're able to have huge insight into the network of operators of this bot. Whereas if it were olden days of the internet and they were using PayPal, let's say, to buy the bot, we would not necessarily have a ton of insight into where those funds were going and who else might be purchasing the bot. So this really is a huge opportunity for fraud fighters and investigators in the space. So what issues do OTP bots pose to financial institutions? Obviously, it's very hard to associate particular sets of victims with a specific OTP bot because it's only one portion of a larger compromise. and an attacker is probably going to try iterative techniques to compromise an account. So you're not going to see a very consistent pattern across a set of victims of an account takeover using an OTP bot. And similarly, it's essentially impossible to anticipate what users are going to be targeted with an OTP bot call. If you are monitoring darknet markets for dumps of user credentials, you might be able to get a heads up that you have some compromised credentials, and you know that's somewhat of a clue. But it's very hard to specifically defend against OTP bot attacks. It's kind of your general account takeover defenses that you're going to rely on. So what are some of the best practices that we can all adopt to try to mitigate the success of OTP bots? By far, the best defense is letting your users use security keys as their second factor authentication. I still find it incredibly frustrating that a number of banks and critical financial institutions do not allow you to add security keys to your account. I can secure my Twitter account with the security key, but my bank account, I can't necessarily do that. I mean, don't get me wrong, my Twitter is very valuable. Got like 80 followers going, it's pretty lit. but it's very frustrating that not more institutions really are embracing security keys and familiarizing more users with how to get comfortable with them. Of course, there's always experimenting with other forms of two-factor authentication, such as biometrics. That has its own issues as well. But essentially, trying to innovate in the two-factor space beyond just one-time passwords provided over a phone or SMS, we're, I'm sure, all very aware how vulnerable that has become. Monitoring for new attack patterns in account takeovers, of course. And then proactive threat landscape monitoring. So having a really robust threat intelligence team can be really critical here to identify bots that are advertising the ability to spoof your particular financial institution. And collaboration between financial institutions. Coinbase has insight into, like we said, the payment infrastructure side of a lot of these bots, but the ultimate purchasers of the bot are trying to target traditional financial institutions. So it was really in collaboration with those other financial institutions that we were able to give law enforcement kind of the whole package into victim details and then also attacker details. And then another hugely important piece of best practices here is teaching our users how to be savvy and defensive and vigilant against these types of social engineering. Just to be extremely skeptical anytime you receive contact from your financial institution. I feel like I've gotten paranoid. Like, my own mother calls me and said, you know, is asking me how my weekend was, and I was like, if you're really my mom, then where did I break my arm in the third grade? So if you also would like to try to see if you have any intelligence on your platform about OTP bots, some obvious keywords that you can search for in your transactions or your, depending on, you know, if you have messaging capabilities, obviously OTP bot, SMS bulk, SMS authenticator, and this is going to be insight on the purchasers of the bot, not necessarily the architects of the bot. But from there, obviously pivoting off of victim accounts that report that there has been some sort of scammy fake outreach from customer support from your institution, and checking, you know, the IP logs, the device fingerprint logs of attempted logins to their account. And telecompanies have a huge role to play in trying to mitigate the robocalls that these spam bots really rely on. So we hope that that gave you guys a little bit of insight into, obviously, OTP bots, but the increasing use of scamming as a service and the increasing sophistication of the new scammer-to-scammer business model that we're probably seeing, that you're all probably seeing a lot as well. But also, I hope you walk away with a little bit of insight into just how valuable blockchain intelligence can be in fighting financial crime, and just what an asset it is when investigating financial crime. Anything else?
I think you summed that up pretty nicely.
So if there's any questions, we'll turn it over to you guys. Yeah.
So that's the question was, do we have any statistics on how many Coinbase accounts have been compromised from OTP bot attacks? We don't have a really great answer for that.
Because it's so hard to attribute an account takeover to an OTP bot, generally they're kind of broadly categorized as email compromised because we don't necessarily know specifically how the two-factor method was compromised unless the victim reports it to us. So that is a really manual process.
Yeah, I want to, statistic-wise, I don't want to give you a wrong number, so I'm just not going to give you a number because I don't want to give you incorrect information, but we have seen a larger number of people purchasing the bot versus the victim, so that list is longer. Only applies to SMS or applies to email, sir? These particular bots are through SMS because these robocalls, it can be customized to whatever, though. The ones that we spoke about today are through texting, but it absolutely can be through email. You could put that in the script or whatnot. It can be taken over anyway.
You're right. You have done quite a bit of analysis here. Is there a way, you are sharing that intelligence with any other software providers in the malware area?
Could you repeat that? I'm sorry.
So sharing this intelligence, it's a consortium data, right? Mm-hmm. So you being in the blockchain, that research what you have done, it should be used by other malware vendors where they can identify these type of threats.
Yeah, so that would be through the blockchain analysis portion of our intelligence gathering. So through different programs, chain analysis, TRM, Coinbase analytics, we have the ability to tag addresses as such. If we are able to determine that an address belongs to a particular institution, or a different exchange, whatnot. So we do have the ability to tag those addresses and within those spaces, the other people using those programs are able to see that that address is for this bot. And we also put sourcing information on there as well. So that way it's not just like me going on there being like, hey, I think this one's a bot. No, we have to have like some actual intelligence to state that is.
Thank you.
I have a question that, like, during the investigation, is it possible for us to maybe gather any IOC of those bots and maybe either use in our organization or share with the clients? Is it possible?
Do you mean, is it possible for us to be gathering IOCs and then sharing those specific IOCs?
Like, yeah, is it doable? Because I know bots are a little bit different from other, like, attack techniques.
It depends on the bot. If it's kind of like a full automated takeover where the bot is also operating the login portion of the attack, and then there's going to be more IOCs there to collect. For just like the bot architect, there's, from our perspective, like mainly the payment address as like the IOC. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, makes sense. Thank you.
If it would be harder to know who's buying and selling the OTP bots on like PayPal, for example, why aren't they selling them on PayPal and on Coinbase instead? Or like buying and selling?
That's a great question, and it's because through PayPal, there's more information that's collected. If you're selling it using cryptocurrency, you don't have to necessarily have your wallet held at an identified exchange. It can be in your own private wallet. So if you're sending out your own private wallet, law enforcement can't subpoena that if it's not identified. Whereas if you're selling on PayPal, law enforcement can send a subpoena for all account holder information, and you know, you get IPs on that if you really want to go into like the nitty gritty. So there's a sense of being anonymous with cryptocurrency and seeing that on those platforms.
So I have a quick question about your scenario. So as you mentioned, you know, it was great that we were able to identify and then catch the bot operator, but I think it was the mercy of the operator hitting the exchange, giving the opportunity for the right person to be able to identify that. But if that malicious actor was not hitting the exchange and then only using the like hardware wallet, and then never hit the exchange, wouldn't it be much harder to identify that transaction?
Yeah, definitely. Like you said, it's only through them sending funds to an mm-hmm. exchange that collects KYC that we're essentially able to de-anonymize who that user is. But you'd be surprised how frequently folks are, I guess, naive or arrogant about sending funds to centralized exchanges like that.
Makes sense. Yeah,
and I think also a lot of folks don't realize how traceable cryptocurrency is, so they think if they just receive payment initially into a private wallet that we can't then trace the funds multiple hops. So there's a certain lack of sophistication of understanding there. That helps us a lot.
Yeah, and then on the other hand too, I mean, not on our end too, not every investigation is successful because it's almost impossible to identify every single purchaser, especially if it's in a private wallet. However, there's still avenues of investigation to go because we're able to see who purchased those bots, and then those are individual fraud rings that are in different jurisdictions, so there's at least some value into that. But to answer your original question, not every investigation on our end is successful too. It depends on how and where the money is going.
Yeah, thank you. One thing I was going to mention was the not every exchange also requires a KYC verification. Mm-hmm. So if the malicious actor was sophisticated enough to use those foreign exchange, I guess it would be also harder to track them as well.
Definitely,
for sure. And we encourage them all to use ones that have KYC so that way we can identify them.
Hi, I'm Gary Warner from Dark Tower. With the proposed legislation changes related to cryptocurrency, do you feel like, at least in the United States, all exchanges will be required to use KYC? And then do you think that will actually change the use of Bitcoin by the criminals? Just curious on your thoughts.
Well, in the US, all cryptocurrency exchanges already have to collect subscriber information. So I don't anticipate it changing in the US, but I think there's always gonna essentially be like regulatory arbitrage with cryptocurrency exchanges because there's always gonna be jurisdictions that are going to be lax on their compliance expectations. And so there's going to be exchanges that take advantage of that. So there will always be some sort of safe haven for criminals to cash out. But even with that being the case, we've still had a lot of success identifying who criminals are because they tend to use multiple exchanges and there's always some sort of, you know, error in their operational security. And a lot of misinformation about where you can collect information on a user. Even with NFT transfers like on OpenSea, lots of people think that that's an entirely private transaction that wouldn't be subpoenaable, but even a transfer of an NFT like that, there's IP data and device fingerprinting to be collected. So there's a lot more intelligence on the blockchain than folks really realize.
Yeah, and of course it's gonna make catching criminals a little bit harder, but to put things in perspective, when cryptocurrency first came out, we all thought the same thing too, but here we are today catching criminals. Abusing it.
We talked about reactive steps, but is there a proactive effort going on to identify those
criminals, right, using machine learning or whatever mode, so that you can see the pattern and upfront keep an eye on those people.
You mean for account takeovers on Coinbase?
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we don't want to get into the specific mechanisms, but of course we definitely have a broad range of kind of anomalous account activity detection.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think that's everything. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming today. We appreciate trying to kick off your RSA. So we hope that you guys have a great rest of the conference. And thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.